All right, we're back in the stude. Klemic Performance Method, the VNL video newsletter here. I'm Coach David Klemic with head coach Josh Holsupple. He was out for a little while. Mm-hmm. He was bulletproof for two straight years. Mm-hmm. Never got the COVID, never got mm-hmm. the nothing. He just was completely bulletproof. I started to actually believe all the crazy cockamamie, what are they called, plans and schemes that he had about not getting sick. And then he was out for a week. We don't know what it was. We don't know. We didn't do any tests, but he had a fever all week and got very skinny over the week. I saw him at the house. I tried to bring him out some medicine, and he's okay now. He's okay.
I'm good now.
Welcome back.
I'm excited to be back.
Yeah. A couple announcements, couple cool things going on. Maybe we had some stuff, some real neat stuff happen in just the past couple weeks since our last video newsletter. Excited to give all that information to you and more right after this break. We're gonna come back with our Who Dat Athletes of the Week. So that was J. Cole, Who Dat song. I love that. I love that. We started that over a year ago now. Mm-hmm. It's been Who Dat Athlete of the Week. Love it. Our kids get down with it. My father-in-law actually says, oh, who's the Who Dat Athlete of the Week? It's so funny. But we got a male and a female Athlete of the Week, and a very proud ones because they've had a long hill to climb to get some passes thrown to them mm-hmm. and this and that, so to make some big plays. So our male Athlete of the Week is
Jake Pfeiffer. I know he's gonna be hype about this. He's always the Athlete of the Week, but this week he got it. He made his debut at the Hunt School at Princeton. They were playing a top ranked team in the country. I actually forget the name, I'm drawing a blank, but they went in there, they won.
Georgia, I think.
Yeah, out of Georgia. I think they played in Georgia. Jake, I think, pretty much had the game-winning touchdown. He had, I think, 40 receiving yards, 60 rushing yards, or 60 receiving yards and 40 rushing yards, just split somewhere in there. But making his debut, scoring a touchdown, being a big part of that Hunt School offense, which, you know, for him to just kind of step in and do. He was out for the first 2 weeks. He had a little bit of an injury, but he's back. He killed it. Scored, you know, his first career Hunt School touchdown, and, you know, we're excited for him. The ball's rolling.
It was only a matter of time. We watched him put up crazy times and jumps.
Numbers, yeah.
Crazy numbers. It was just a matter of time until he was in an offense that fit him a little bit better. He was kind of like a tweener for that high school style mm-hmm. offense. Now when you get around other athletes that are, you know, you have a lot of 4-star, you know, guys, maybe even 5 stars over there mm-hmm. at like the Hunt or Petty. Mm-hmm. And it's not to take anything away from the dominance of the prep program.
Yeah.
But it just doesn't use the tight end like that. Mm-hmm. And he was a tight end fullback who uses it.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Now, you can see what, even at the next level, where he'll be able to fit right in.
100%.
Fit perfectly mm-hmm. in there in multiple positions because he's got that height, that speed,
size,
combination.
Yeah, speed.
He catches balls, he's got moves.
Explosive.
D-line. He's got it all. Very smart. Drives a cool car, too. He's got a Raptor like me. Pretty mad that he's in high school with a Raptor, and I'm 46 years old with a Raptor. A little bit mad at you, but, bro, nothing but love for you. We're so proud mm-hmm. of you. Congratulations. And our female Who Dat Athlete of the Week is Gabriella Piantedosi, who has her first goal in college. And it was exciting because I saw her have her first assist, and mm-hmm. I got real pumped for it. And I was like, I'm going to wait until she gets that first goal. But mm-hmm. she got her first collegiate goal to Division I.
Yeah, as a freshman, that's serious.
We saw her in here really start to believe in herself.
Like
it was one thing that we to watch her just get her scores and everything, but like to watch her believe in herself and come back and like want to tell them like, hey, you see what I just did, and putting up scores mm-hmm. that the guys were putting up.
Yeah,
and she was, you could see that just starting to build up in her, and mm-hmm. I could, you just see that in.
She had a great entrance and exit. I think she hit 6 inches on her mark for vertical leap from beginning to end, and her times got extremely fast. She just started to be able to and go, just
not
accelerate.
From a 3-point stance, from standing.
No, standing
up.
And just go,
and
rip
she
it.
Could go. She was in the 1.6s in her 10-yard mm-hmm. dash, which, and she's hitting over like 18 miles per hour. We just stuff that on a soccer field is just invaluable.
Mm-hmm. Exactly,
and she did it all. So she's got a bright future. And we're gonna see her again probably this year on the Who Dat. So,
yeah, for sure.
We're so proud of you guys both. Congratulations. And next, we're going to get into our announcements.
All right.
Big announcement probably, and it's not – it's we're just kind of announcing the we're just kind of putting this out there. This is going to be like our last call for our basketball players. So you're about 12 weeks exactly till December 1st. That's going to be like the end of your Thanksgiving break when you'll probably have the first basketball practice, right? So this is a last call for you guys. We have a number of basketball players in here from Holy Spirit, Royal Catholic, Ocean City. But this is time. Yeah. So if you're going to do it now, because then you'll have a full cycle to get in right
12
before.
Weeks. Mm-hmm.
What's important? What's important about 12 weeks for basketball players?
Well, you know, it's we've been saying it for a while, but, you know, basketball players from a general physical preparedness standpoint are some of the most underdeveloped athletes. They struggle with range of motion. They actually, most basketball kids struggle to jump vertically. I know it sounds crazy because basketball is a lot of jumping and movement, but most basketball players just struggle to produce force and actually jump up into the air. They struggle to actually accelerate and get themselves going. We've tested a number of basketball teams, and, you know, there's been throughout all of them, maybe two or three kids that athletically were like, okay, that's a pretty good athlete. You know, for the most part, basketball players are not developed, and this 12 weeks is a very, very crucial time in order to develop that prior to the season. You know, because you're going to want to go in there and be able to cover and create as much space as possible. Most basketball players around here aren't 6'5", 6'6". So in order for you to compete and really dominate in your sport, you need to be able to expand the amount of range you can cover or create. So offensively, you want to maximize the amount of space you can create. That means three-dimensionally, left, right, up, center, you know, all over these different places where you can get the ball to and actually roll and lay up and jump and do all of that, and then defensively be able to cover all of that three-dimensional space as well. So if you come in to us, you have 12 weeks, we're going to improve that at 24%, and you're going to become a actually objectively better basketball player because you're able to cover and create more space. Instead of shooting for the next 12 weeks, which is great, and you can still shoot when you train with us, or instead of just going doing and, you know, runs or whatever you do at the court with your friends, come in and actually get better so you can set yourself up to have a great season coming up.
Offensively, we can speak defensively because of the objective reasons. Subjectively, an offensive player would want to jump higher on their jump shot. The higher you are, the more range you have. So if you're starting the point of your shot from a higher, from a 6 inches higher perspective, the shot is much, much easier and has much more range, also less blockable. Rebounding, which is, think defensively, rebounds an offensive, it's an offensive movement where you're getting the ball off of the rim to get it to put it back. If you're 6 inches higher, you're getting more rebounds, you're getting more you're getting more opportunities to score points.
And when you can move better, you can, you know, again, like, you're able to change the way you get to the rim because now you can be a step ahead of where you were just at. You're reacting faster. You're able to get up off the ground better. So now you can attack the rim from angles that you normally couldn't take before because you didn't have the physical ability to do it. And I'm telling you, I want to harp on it. If you play basketball, I promise you, you're going to come in here and it's going to change the way you play because you're way less athletic than you think you are, to be honest with you. Because when you come in here and you actually test, and we've tested probably close to 100 basketball kids this past offseason. Not many. I think we maybe had 5 that jumped over 30 inches and 2 that were at like 34, 35.
And
the whole thing.
2 that went over 18 miles per hour.
Yeah.
It's very, very. If you guys, this is Chip, the words from Chip Smith. And I think if you're trying to find, well, Chips would say that the basketball players are the laziest athletes around, right? And also the least prepared, which leaves them most exposed to knee injuries and all that stuff. However, if you were trying to find an edge somewhere, if there was one place where you could find an edge, it would be through athleticism, right?
Yeah.
Because if everybody else is at everybody else is out dribbling and shooting and this and that, but you were trying to find an edge, it's got to be the biggest edge you could find is through sheer athleticism, knowing that every team we tested was very low on the athletic scale.
And their best kids were their best athletes. Like, when you actually tested them, the best kids on the team were the best athletes, you know, from all the tests that we did. And we had Samaj Bethea and Elijah Brown, you know, 2 years ago from the prep when they were there, you know, since they've gone to Life Center in Camden. But dude, those kids came in and they did it while they were playing AAU. Yeah, they had to miss one session every, you know, week or two. They came into an AAU. They both added 7 inches to their vertical leap. They both increased, or they both decreased their 10-yard dash times by like a tenth and a half. So then they go into their senior year playing basketball, and they're like, Elijah was like head at the rim dunking. You know what
Samad
I'm saying?
Got his first dunk in through
that
process.
Yeah, through us, so. Yeah. How many basketball kids have gotten their first dunk in while
Timmy
training
traveling,
with us?
Timmy traveling, yeah. On a bet, too.
Yeah, cool. Like a ton of kids, but basketball needs to get in here.
Yeah, so, I mean, last call for a basketball player. If you don't get in, I would say by this weekend, I would say skip it.
Yeah.
Because we have to get a 12-week cycle in. So, time to come in now. And then we'll go over the next announcement, really, is We did some things to the gym. We were the facility. It's not a gym. Not at all. Changed the isolation area.
Mm-hmm.
So we expanded that by 4 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So that allows us to do our broad jumping, our lateral bounds, and resistances and different depth drops and stuff like that, decelerations and everything from there instead of having to do it in our application area. So now this is even more space than we had at the barn when we first started. So we do have that going for us now, and we bought 8 brand new jump mats, broad jump mats for that area. So now we have
every lane has a mat.
Every lane has a broad jump mat. Which is cool. Every time we do something, we want one
every
for
lane,
everybody.
Yeah, every lane needs to have one.
Thing. So it gets expensive, but it's worth it when the test scores go through the roof like that. So next, we're going to go through our announcements that are outside the four walls.
Okay.
So, number one, let's pick up this shoe. This is called the Antepes Muscle Runner. Now, of all the cool things that we were getting to do, consensus right now, and I thought the Naval Academy thing was the coolest. Mm-hmm. This is pretty darn cool.
Yeah.
We also work with Tracer Company. That's pretty darn cool, too. But no disrespect to either one of those. But Naval Academy, that was like honorable.
Yeah.
But this is cool. We're going to review this shoe called the Antepes Muscle Runner right here live. And then we're going to do it also on our social media. So what you have here is a shoe that is like a track spike trainer. Okay, so it has a carbon fiber plate in here and a negative heel drop. So you have more front than you do back, just if you put that simply. Now, I ran track in college, and I wore the long jump shoe. The long jump shoe has a more, like the heel drop, with a bigger front lift. So when you jump, you get a more, when you long jump, you get a nice little roll off and you feel a little bit lifted up. I love that so much, that feeling that I started putting lifts in the front of my shoe when I ran the 200. Mm-hmm. I didn't really need it in the 55, but in the 200, I wanted the lift or the 100. And I started training like that too. And it puts you more up in a heel off the ground position, and you get to stay higher up on the ball of your foot, thus developing your Achilles tendon. So, which is a collagen dense area of your body. And this is one of these things that develops collagen. Now, in the past, there was this thing called a strength shoe that would put, that had a big platform underneath. It was very clunky.
Yeah.
And it would be almost better just to stand and walk in.
Yeah.
This thing you actually train in, you can run on any surface with it, grass, street, whatever, and it puts you on the ball of your foot at all times. What's the first thing that we see? The first problem that we see with every athlete?
Yeah, so this is why I love these, is because every athlete that comes in here, like 96%, I would say, walk on their heels, run on their heels, jog on their heels, change direction on their heels. Like, everything that an athlete does that comes in here, for the most part, is done on their heels. And that's just through wearing footwear that was the opposite of this. So instead of the heel being elevated, the toe is elevated. Or I'm sorry, instead of the heel being off of the ground, it's the main part of the shoe that's on the ground. So every air bubble shoe is like this. So now kids' feet are just used to using their heel every time they strike the ground when they go to walk. And then it goes into running, and it develops poor feet pretty much that start to turn out and start to go up the chain, and all of a sudden kids have back problems and knee problems and are at risk for higher injury of knees and all this other stuff. But long story short, this will solve almost all of that, because you are forced to stay on the ball of the foot when you run. You can't run in these shoes heel first. It's like impossible. You'll feel it right away, and you'll just be working against yourself. So this is meant to develop the lower leg, which we know is the carrier force. And if you cannot carry your force, it's pretty much rendered useless, or you're getting a percentage of the amount of force you can actually create out of your run, out of each step, because you can't successfully transfer it through your forefoot up your leg into your Achilles tendon, your soleus, your gastroc, and then bounce back out and use all of that. So these are meant to do that. I've worn these, you know, for a while. You've had a good amount of use with them. I feel my feet get stronger in these, and I feel my upper leg and the Achilles definitely changes and feels a lot different. And when you run in these, it's like a track spike. It teaches you how to run and strike and pull the ground and strike and pull the ground without using your heel. I definitely think that these are going to take off. And I'm glad to be, you know, that we're a part of it.
And we are a part of it because you can order them here. You can use our code to get a discount on these shoes, and you can't buy them anywhere else. They sell them only on their website. So you would go through us. We'll give you the code, and we'll leave it in the bottom here. Mm-hmm. We'll leave the code here. It's Klemic. Mm-hmm. And you're going to go to purchase and then look at the code. If you type in Klemic, you'll get the discount. You'll get a 10% discount. And they're $174. They were dropped. They were $225. Mm-hmm. I think they're going to go back up again. They're bringing another shipment soon. So that's when the price will go back up. I think that starts at the end of September.
Okay.
So it'll go back up. But if you get it now, you'll get the 10% off of $174. So we also sell these. You know, you can try them on here and just try them on. We have a size range from 7.5 to 12.5, and they're unisex. So it goes by men's sizes. Mm-hmm. But they were phenomenal. The more that I wore these, the more – and I put it on – I actually put them on and ran on a treadmill. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, like, you know, it was very similar to running up the pitch. And you cannot strike in front of your body. Like, you can't heel strike or overstride. So by doing that, you're getting more quad. You're getting more glute. You're running in a powerful manner versus just a pull, stop, and just re – and just – have a lazy running style. Mm-hmm. If you ever watch people that run fast, nobody ever touches their heel to the ground. Yeah. That is very, very, very rare.
Nobody's fast is a lazy running style.
No. So you're running, it forces you not only to be on the ball of your foot, but then you get, with that extra bounce that you get off the ball of your foot, your knee lifts a little bit higher. So it starts to sequence. You start to sequence a little bit better. These things are really important for young athletes, even if you don't train in here.
Yeah.
Just to wear these around, walk around in them and everything like that. Like, they look pretty normal. They don't look like a goof, something that's too goofy.
Yeah.
Do look like a running shoe. But if you walk around on the ball of your foot, people may talk about you until they talk about you because you're performing well. And then they'll go, hey, where'd you get those?
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, phenomenal shoe. Since we're a facility that constantly tries to develop an athlete's stride length, stride frequency, this does both. It lengthens the stride because you get more of a bounce. You're not leaving energy in the ground. When you strike your heel to the ground, we do this all the time. It's like if you're jumping rope and started, you can feel it right now. If you jump rope and drop your heels into the ground, your whole house is going to shake, right? You're going to hurt your legs. You're not going to be able to recycle energy. Staying on the ball of your foot, you're able to recycle energy. The power that you put into the ground is being recreated right back into your foot, propelling you to where you want to go. And then lifting your knee higher, we're able to force our foot back down to the ground in a powerful, advantageous position versus disadvantageous position where you're striking out in front of you and pulling. So even when I was playing football, I remember going to to the combine or running, doing my pro day in it was actually at Boston College, and I cut the spikes off the back of my shoes. I've done this for anybody that I've trained that's gone to the combine or the pro day. I'll take their spikes and or their cleats and cut the back off to force them to the ball of their foot. And that's just for the day. That's just for training and stuff. I don't want them to ever think, you know, go outside your frame and pull.
Yeah.
You want to push. And so these things do just that. I absolutely love them. I think it's a steal for what they could be charging for these things. And they do have a carbon fiber plate, which, you know, costs probably $75.
Yeah, that's the same thing that the Victor insoles are, is a carbon plate. So these have that built in. Carbon plate built in, just like a track spike. I think that as we get going and as we start to break these down, you're going to see a lot of it on our social media. These things are going to be pretty much – required almost by everybody because they're that good. They legitimately change how you run. You feel what it's like to run fast when you're in these, and you feel what it's like to have great running form in these, because it just makes you apply the right mechanics in order to sprint. So,
and you don't have to be in the track to do it. That's the thing.
No.
You can go out on the street to do this.
Be in the street, in the grass. I wear these almost as a daily right now. I know I'm on right now, but my feet feel, when I wear these, they're sore in a different way, which is a good thing. That means that I'm building up the muscle and the tendons and the ligaments in order to be able to handle more force in the forefoot. So I'm excited for them.
Yeah. Every time you think about any collagen densifying exercise, you got to think either your body's going to process through hypertrophy and muscle protein synthesis or collagen synthesis. And by doing lower than maximum capacity, lots of reps when you're running. If you see cross country runners, they actually have really good RSI scores. Mm-hmm, we can actually measure this of the increases from using the shoe itself on how well you connect to the ground.
Yeah.
So the faster the contact to the ground, the more you're going to propel yourself. You want to mm-hmm. be off the ground. The more you're going to propel yourself up in the air or forward. So we can measure that through the RSI test, and we have. And the fastest athletes that we've ever coached have also had the highest RSI score. So this is forcing that RSI score to go up. It's doing all the exercises that we do on pogos and jumping mm-hmm. rope and everything. It's doing it on a daily basis on steroids.
Mm-hmm.
So happy to be asked. We're actually shooting a commercial for them.
Yeah.
Coming up really soon, probably next week or so. Mm-hmm. We are excited to work with these guys. They are hungry. They're flying us out to the
Austin, Texas.
November 18th to the 21st.
Mm-hmm.
It's called the Run Show.
Mm-hmm.
Run Show. Yeah. It's the biggest running event in the country. So we're going to be out there representing Climbing Performance Method, but Antiep's Muscle Antiep's, Runners.
Yeah.
We're proud to do it. I can't believe the neat stuff that we've been able to do in the past couple years, but really the past couple months, all the neat stuff that's coming up.
Oh, yeah.
And it's piling on, and we can't wait to see everybody put these on and give it a shot. When you come in, you can try them out over mm-hmm. here too, because we have the size run.
Yeah.
So everything from 7.5 to 12.5, please try them on and mess with them. And if you love them, go ahead and get that, and we'll get you a pair discounted in here. And then lastly, we're going to go into our shout outs for today. Our shout outs. All right. Got a bunch of shout outs. Couple cool things, but you know, Kenny Randall from the Jacksonville Jaguars and the CFL and the UFL mm-hmm. is coming back in, start working to training with us, because he's
awesome.
He's close to getting signed right now, mm-hmm. so he's got to stay in shape right now. He's got heard from a couple teams just recently, so we got to keep him in shape. Second, Jaron Hayek is out temporarily mm-hmm. with a little hip issue, but Jaron Hayek from the Kansas City Chiefs will be back here next week, and we're training him all through his IR process, which stands for injured reserve. Jeff Hurd, the strength conditioning coach of the Kansas City Chiefs, was my coach. He was also the coach of the Vikings, the Chargers, and the Jaguars. He was on the radio show on the Locker Room ESPN radio this weekend. It was awesome to hear from him and talk about the origins of strength and conditioning training and then where it's going now. We're doing a follow-up with him this weekend, I think on the Saturday show. If you want to hear him talk about how it is evolved and what the difference between strength and conditioning and performance and everywhere in between.
Yeah, I think that'll be a cool one. I hope that, you know, some of the kids tune into that one, because I think it's always great to have them hear it not from us. You know what I mean? Hear from a former NFL strength coach and have him get into kind of the nitty-gritty of, like, this is what has changed. You need to change along with it if you want to actually get to the pinnacle of sport, the NFL, or the NBA, or the NHL, or whatever sport you guys are playing.
Yeah, this week we got – first week we had him only for 15 minutes, and it got a little bit emotional because he talked about how he thought that I was a special athlete mm-hmm. and was one of the people that was pounding the table for me to make the roster mm-hmm. in Kansas City and made it through cuts, because I was one of the weight room guys, you know, mm-hmm. one of the guys that that really cared at all times,
yeah.
which is something that I really want to explain to our kids. You never know who's watching.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea that Coach Hurd would be in the draft room or would be part of the cut process. Mm-hmm. And he was. He was as much of a vote as any of the other coaches. And he said, yeah, I'm in that room. And if you guys, if you're a lazy weight room guy, I'm not. You're not getting my vote.
Yeah.
Or if you're a cancer in there, or if you're not positive. He's like, you know, Dave, you have me all the way. Like, and the relationship that we had was it goes way past the weight room and football. It goes into, you know, we have a great relationship, a spiritual relationship too, which is awesome. So, Coach Hurt, I love you. It's great having you on. We'll have him back. That's neat. You guys want to hear that type of information? If not, I'll take that and I'll clip that on our the YouTube and I'll put it on, back on the channel too, so you guys can hear him talk. Amazing speaker too. He was just on the show. The Chief Concern, the Kansas City Chiefs podcast.
Awesome.
So run by Jason Dunn, who's also been on the show also. Shout outs. Okay. McClear's, you always going to get shout outs, but you guys are balling. Every last one of you.
Yeah.
We got to throw shout outs to McClear's. Interceptions in the end zones.
Yeah.
Recoveries on onside kicks.
Yeah.
Tristan having a an interception in the end zone.
Yeah.
Ty balling.
Yeah. Tegan's doing well.
Tegan's doing well. So that's some shout outs right there. Oh gosh, DeMar, you're getting offers from the South now.
Yeah, he's getting the SECs, the Texas, Auburn. I think those are the only two SECs right now, but Texas is the number one team in the country. So, you know, you just got offered by them.
It's unbelievable what
Alabama, what's Georgia's next. Him, those, you know? those two.
What a kid next. That's 300 pounds, like almost 300 pounds, that can jump 30 plus inches on the vertical leap. That looks like that on the field, too.
Yeah, well, again, just a kid who bought into training. You know, he could have easily just got a, you know, fitness membership at Planet Fitness or Tillis and did a bunch of workouts like everybody else. He did his school workouts, and he comes here. And, you know, that's why he's getting offers. He's one of the most explosive defensive tackles at his size in the whole country. And if you don't believe us, just ask the 20 schools that have offered him, you know.
Mainland's Jake Blum. Is well on his way to break my scoring record. I had 11 touchdowns my senior year, and receiving touchdowns on 29 catches. I think he has 29 catches already and 6 touchdowns already, and he missed a game. I think he missed the Millville game. So he had 4 in one game, 2 in another. He's balling. So, Jake, you can get 10 touchdowns. You can't get 11. No, you're doing great. Congratulations. And then David Washington has his first catch for University of Kentucky.
Okay, I didn't know that. Yeah, that's awesome.
His first catch, and he was also named September standout scholar athlete.
It's awesome.
Which is great. So we're super proud of
him. I'm going to shout out the prep defense too. We got, you know, those linebackers, Julian Jambuzzi, Matt, Dan Fran, like they're shutting down, you know, New Jersey or South Jersey, almost everybody they play. They had some hiccups last week, but it wasn't really due to those guys. But they are killing it. If you ever watch them play or watch their highlights, they're just coming downhill and destroying everything. Sideline to sideline, it doesn't matter. They're playing extremely well. They look like guys that spent a, you know, really good offseason in here. And Ty Watson, too. Shout out Ty Watson for all his spirit. Yeah. Comes in after having to sit, you know, kind of a stupid role, having to sit. But comes in, gets an interception, is a big part of the team at Holy Spirit. Love to see that. You know, finally getting a shot to go out there and play and ball out, and that's exactly what he did.
Where you can find us this week, Friday, we wouldn't miss this for the birth of my children. Mainland playing St. Augustine's Prep at St. Augustine's Prep. We are just ecstatic. So what we're going to try to do at the conclusion of this game, don't leave. We're going to try to get all the KPM athletes on the field and take a picture at the same time.
Yeah.
We do this every year just with the prep guys, and then it is a lot of them.
Yeah.
So between the two teams, win, lose, or draw, stay out there for a few minutes and just come take a picture with us. You'll see there's like 24, I think we counted the other day, 24 between the two schools.
I think that there's, it might be there's more than that. Yeah.
So – We'd love to have you guys. Yeah, it ended up being more because we weren't even counting the eighth graders that were coming in.
Yeah.
So, but if you're there, let's take a picture together. You know, as a training family, we support each other even if you're playing against each other. Happened to me a lot. I would train in Atlanta with Chip Smith, and I used to at the end of the games, the guys I would talk to all the time were the guys I trained with, and we'd go over and hug each other after games, pray together. You know. Get together, have dinner even right after the game when we could, because you know, they used to have Derek Thomas's mom would make dinner for both teams.
Wow.
And we would get to meet Mrs. Thomas that's and awesome. Stuff like that. So it was cool. And I would hang out with the guys I trained with. That's how that's kind of what kept us all bonded. Mm-hmm. And when you go through that much pain and suffering together, you tend to bond at some point. So we'll be there. We wouldn't miss it.
Yeah.
You can find us probably near Mr. McClear at some point where he's going to be screaming his head off.
Yeah.
But we'll definitely be there. So I think that concludes all our announcements, too. If we forgot you, we didn't forget you. We just didn't have time to get you in there today. But anyway, from Clemic Performance Method, see you next time.